Good morning, I'm T.Y. Chang from TYT Investigates, and today I'm going to talk about something that is dear to my heart, and that is plastic bottles. This is a terrible one. This is a good one, and I'll explain why in a moment. But we all drink plastic water from plastic bottles. We shouldn't. There are 1,500 plastic bottles that end up in landfills or in the ocean every second. 1,500, 3,000, 4,500. So just in the few seconds I've been talking about it, 10,000 plastic bottles just went into the landfills or oceans. And the energy used to manufacture plastic bottles could power 190,000 homes. And there are 60 million plastic bottles thrown away every day. 60 million. That comes to 22 billion plastic bottles, 22 billion of these, 22 billion every year are thrown away. And it's a rising trend. One statistic was from 1997 until 2004, six times as many plastic bottles were thrown away. Now, in terms of recycling, and by the way, when you throw away a plastic bottle like this, it survives or lasts for 1,000 years. 1,000 years, just think about that. This plastic bottle will be in existence after long after all of us are gone. So for 1,000 years, and in that time that the 1,000 years that this plastic bottle takes to disintegrate, finally, in that 1,000 years, the chemicals within this plastic bottle are leaked into the environment and end up in us, end up in the environment, end up in animals, and ultimately end up in us. Now, in 2018, 28.9% of all plastics were recycled. Now, 80% of the plastics that get recycled are plastic water bottles. And all plastic water bottles are recyclable. Unlike like those thin plastic garbage bags, they're not recyclable. But these are recyclable. But we don't recycle them. What happens, though, is that because Americans in particular use 70 million of these bottles per day, every single day. I don't know if that the math actually works out to that to 22 billion. But what happens is that as we drink this one bottle of water and then we throw it away, it enters our ecosystem. It's going to either to landfills, incinerators, or ending up in the ocean. And when it ends up in the ocean, we in fact have into our ecosystem every week, every one of us eats the equivalent of a plastic credit card worth of plastic into our system through our foods, through whatever we're drinking. And that amounts to about 0.5 pound of plastic per year. Now, you've probably heard about this. If you haven't, this is a revelation. And that is that we have in the ocean, in the Pacific, the size of the state of Texas, there's something they call the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, which is basically all this kind of garbage, most of it plastic. So I am going to try now to see if I can make sure that I get, here we go. Yes, so now we have, and I have the chats them into our chats on my computer. And I hope you can hear me well. The last time I noticed the microphone I had wasn't working too well, so I'm going to try this one here. In any case, getting back again, we Americans drink 70 million bottles like this of this plastic bottled water every year. And a lot of it ends up in the Pacific Ocean in particular, because what was happening was that we would transfer the American garbage over to different countries, and the countries, different various countries, I guess mainly in Asia, and then they were just throwing it into the ocean. For a long time, the U.S. was sending its garbage to China, which would take the garbage and recycle because of the metals and the glass and even some of the plastic. But then China got to the point where it had too much garbage from America and said, we can't take it anymore. So now there are a number of places that are basically a number of municipalities that are saying that we can't take televisions, we can't take any large objects because there's nowhere to bring it anymore. So it's going into landfills, and a lot of it's just ending up in the ocean. The Great Pacific Garbage Patch, which is the size of Texas, think about that, an island in the Pacific the size of Texas that's all human garbage. So the plastics have nowhere to go, and so they're ending up in landfills and incinerators, and basically right now, even the recycled plastics, most of it in the U.S., is ending up in basically storage. It's being crushed and then being stored because they have nowhere to go for it. Although plastic bottles in particular can be recycled, only 28.9% in 2018, that's all plastics were recycled. Although I don't know the exact percentage of the plastic bottles, but many of them are not, clearly. Now, one thing that's fascinating about recycling of plastics is if you look at the bottom, like this bottle on the bottom here has a triangle, and that triangle has a one. That means it's recyclable. But if you look at a lot of the plastics, like four and fives, those are not recyclable, and they end up in landfills. So the majority of our plastics, in fact, end up in landfills and incinerators. Only 28.9% gets recycled in 2018. And so, you know, so basically 71.1% do not get recycled. And here's the scam about all this. The plastics industries for a while actually did a lot of promotion and public relations campaigning, talking about how great recycling is, how plastic bottles were being turned into jackets, fleece jackets were made from plastic bottles. I know I bought one just because I saw that. It turns out that in reality, there is very little recycling, only 28.9% in 2018, 71.1%, in fact, ends up not being recycled. And that's the reality of it going to landfills in the ocean and going into them. Now, one thing you can do is you can reuse this bottle since it's going to last for 1,000 years. The problem with that is that when you reuse this bottle over and over, two things can happen. The chemicals in the bottle will slowly leak from the water that you fill this with into your system. The second thing is bacteria can build into the bottle if you reuse it over and over and over again. So that's this type of plastic bottle. Now, this type of plastic bottle, and I'm not going to show the name because it doesn't really matter, but this is a BPA-free plastic bottle that I have, and it's reusable. And what's good about this is that if you open it up, and I got this from Amazon, it has a little charcoal filter at the bottom. So theoretically, you could go to a stream, fill this up, and then you squeeze the bottle like this, and water comes out. But it's filtered water. So theoretically, you could actually go to a mountain stream and fill this up, and then you could drink this safely. And that's a different use of plastic. This is a plastic that, rather than throw it away, it is reusable over and over again. And because of the filter, it should be able to, you know, filter out whatever chemicals are in there. And that's something that I use a lot instead of doing the plastic bottles. Now, one of my kids likes to drink water out of plastic bottles, and I asked why, and the answer was because it's so easy. But this is really, really bad for the environment. Now, there are some who argue that we have to talk about a sustainable future and deal with the big issues first. I agree. Deal with the big issues. But a smaller issue on a personal level, and this is the individual level, it's the same argument about voting. Well, if I don't vote, it really won't make any difference. But if 120 million people all think, well, if I don't vote, it won't make any difference, it does make a difference. And since we as Americans drink 70 million bottles of plastic water every day, it does make a personal difference whether we, in fact, drink water from plastic bottles. So my suggestion is get a bottle like this, heavier plastic, drink all your water from there, and don't buy these anymore. And I know I'm guilty of doing the same thing. Even though I know all this, you know, I've been bottled, but now I just have to convince my kids. Although they're pretty good about when they go to school, they have their own personal bottle. My wife got them, and it's not a plastic bottle like this. It's one of the heavier plastics like this. And in fact, I think one of them has a steel one, and they drink from that, and they fill that up. And that's really the way we should be going. So that's my take on plastic bottles. It's something I wanted to talk about because it's also about this whole thing about personal choices don't matter as much as the big choices. And that's true. We have to deal with societal changes, dealing with, you know, fossil fuel, and we have to deal with the sustainable, you know, green energy, et cetera, renewable energy. Yes, that's all true, but it does make a difference on a personal level. For example, one simple thing, stop drinking plastic water from plastic bottles. And then, you know, because one thing that's happening too is that the plastic bottles in that great Pacific garbage patch in the Pacific Ocean, that's the marine animals, when this does break down to smaller pieces, they see that as food and they're eating it. So it's entering the fish. The animals are eating the plastic, the mammals and the fish, and we're eating the fish. And then that's ending up in our system. So the plastic is coming back. And as an old expression says, the chickens come home to roost in that regard. And so again, that's my take about, that's the issue I wanted to talk about, but let's, as they say, they used to say, let's go to the videotape. Now let's go to the live chats. I'm going to scroll down. Boo Radley says, what is the environmental footprint of one of those reusable bottles? Good question. The energy to make one of those reusable bottles, I'm not sure, but I'm sure it's a lot less if you use a reusable. For example, this bottle here I've had for a year. So if I were to do the average American of drinking 70 million bottles per day, 330 million, let's say in a year I would have purchased 100 to 200 of these. I think purchasing this one and in a year and not purchasing 200 to 300 bottles of water, and that's assuming I only drink one bottle of water, I think no matter what, that's going to be a good thing. But that's something I should look up, and I'm going to write that down. Boo Radley saying environmental footprint of a plastic bottle. And Tamara Nelson says, TYT investigates, what would be best reusable, glass, plastic, or metal? Well, how about this? In whatever is reusable, I think glass generally has the least interaction, but then breaks. So I know I use a stainless steel bottle myself. When I was in television and I had to travel a lot, I used a stainless steel bottle because it didn't deteriorate and it didn't rust, and it was pretty sturdy. Whereas a plastic bottle, I think in all my travels probably would have cracked a few times. So, but that's personal. That's not based on science right now, what I just told you. So, Imperator One at Tamara Nelson, TY, or thank you for boosting my Q. You're welcome. I hope I did boost it a little bit. And by the way, you can just, if you Google plastic bottle use, you'll get a lot more information than I just told you. So Adrian Benningfield says, are there groups cleaning up that large plastic spot in the ocean? CBS News, 60 Minutes, reported that there was a young man who came up with an idea to clean it up, to scoop up some of the plastic, but it didn't work. And so far, I've not heard of anything yet to scoop up the plastic. So the first thing that all of us can do is just stop putting the plastic in there, and then we can figure out something to do that maybe. And I'm sure, not sure, but if we put our minds to it, maybe there would be a way for, if we develop technology to use, for example, solar energy or wind energy or geothermal or even wave energy, if we could develop something like that to decompose this plastic and at least, you know, turn it into kind of construction material, that'd be great. But the point is we're putting way too much plastic in and not taking enough out. No matter how many things we recycle from that, we're not really able to recycle all of the waste that we're putting in. We're only recycling 28.9%. That means 71%, you know, 22 billion tons per year is going in. And this has been going on for decades. So June Henry says, all plastics are petroleum products. None are good. BPAs are replaced by just as awful chemicals. Metal and glass are better. Some glass have coverings that help protect. Okay, that's the point. I have seen glass bottles that have, you know, soft covers on them. I'm just saying that when I was reporting, you know, I had my bag of tricks, I called it, was a laptop and equipment and makeup and different things. But I had a steel water bottle that I basically would drink during the day, and it went through a lot and had all kinds of dents, but it survived all kinds of crashes of my bag and stuff and running around after people. Tamara Nelson said, I've been replacing all my storage containers to glass too. Good idea. My wife has been taking these, after I complained about throwing away too many plastic bottles, she's been putting our water in big plastic bottles. And I was just thinking that we've got to switch all of that to glass and stop using, hopefully not buy any more plastic for a long time, unless we buy a plastic like this that we can reuse over and over and over hundreds of times. In fact, this one in particular, I think this bottle is 2 years old, so I maybe saved 500 bottles, plastic water bottles. So Imperator once said, go old school and use wood. Okay, well, you know, I don't know, a wood cup would be kind of fun to use. And just as my friend gave me the Republican point, talking point about COVID being the same as the flu. Okay, well, then your Republican friend is not basing his information on facts. The flu did kill 57,000 people last flu season, but we've had more than 100,000, and it would have been a whole lot more had we not gone into sheltering. So that's your Republican friend should be looking at the facts. Tamara Nelson says, Michigan is a great example of why we shouldn't have so many dams, especially privately owned dams that are basically not, that are able to ignore environmental regulations, apparently. That happened in the dam near Midland, Michigan, which was near several Superfund toxic sites. Tamara Nelson says, at just a reminder that thousands die from the flu, but COVID spreads much faster and easier. Yes, the COVID virus is, they said 3% infection rate versus 1-point-something for flu. And they said that basically it doubles and triples. It doubles on almost a daily basis in the infection rate. Let me move down here. Barbara Crisp says, I covet the Berkey filtration system. Can't afford it. Berkey. There are a number of filtration systems that are not as expensive as that. I know now, I don't know, I'm pushing this, but a friend of mine has something he calls the blue bottle. And he's manufactured it in the United States, and he donates, I think, about 10% of the profit from making the this water filtration system. He donates it to different charities. And he's somebody that used to be my instructor, my jiu-jitsu instructor. Max McGarr, who's originally from Maine, and he's a great fisherman, but he never eats the fish. He's a fly fisherman. He catches all these huge fish and doesn't eat them, which is very contrary to the Chinese thinking in terms of eating fish. We love eating fish. Well, everybody does, but many people do. But anyway, so he catches the fish and he always puts them back. And I ask him, have you ever eaten one of the fish? He says, no, can't do it. He says, they're too pretty. Any case, so Mr. Elder says, capitalism was sold to the people as being convenient. Why waste time making supper when you can have a TV dinner in a plastic throwaway dish so convenient? I don't know that that's only capitalism, but yes, that was something. But I was always surprised when I would see those ads for TV dinners and they looked so delicious. And then I actually ate a TV dinner and I thought, oh my God, this tastes so bad compared to fresh food. And yes, in a plastic tray, and it is all about convenience. And that's something that we have to change, I think, our mentality. And Jeff Gibbs and Michael Moore, in their much criticized movie, Planet of the Humans, did have one good point, in my opinion. And that was, the first thing is that we have to change our idea of consumption. That we have to change this idea that we can have everything that we want. We can fly anywhere we want. We can drive any kind of car we want. We can have a car. We don't have to take trains. We shouldn't, you know, we have to change our mentality, especially in the United States, is the world's number one polluter. Change that mentality, and so that we understand that we cannot continue to live this way and still exist on the planet. And there is no planet B, as they say. There's only one planet. Until somebody comes up with a dilithium crystal for warp speed, we're stuck here for a long, long time. And so in any case, let's see. MAGZ Focus says, the knowledge is great, but how do we market the necessary change whose motto is, give me convenience or give me death? Well, I think what we do is what we're doing now, environmental education, letting people know, yes, it is about death. And that even with the pandemic, scientists are saying that because we keep destroying the wildlife habitat, shrinking and shrinking, more and more wildlife is interacting that normally would not interact, and they're contaminating each other, and then that's eventually reaching humans. So once we understand that what we're doing is destroying the world and will lead to our, you know, very existence of the human race disappearing after only about, what, a million or so years, which is very, very short, a short time, the 4 billion year history of the Earth, that maybe if people understand, yes, we're all about to die, you know, and my children will be facing this, and my teenage kids, and that's something that I worry about a lot. And maybe that is what it is. Give me convenience, give me death. Maybe that should be a good, that should be a good phrase there. Let's see who said that. MAGZ Focus. Maybe that's a good expression you should propagate and tell everyone, give me convenience or give me death. Say, hey, let's forget the convenience. Let's start doing things in a more sustainable way. And it is possible to do that. Like step one, stop drinking bottled water. You know, this kind of plastic, cheap plastic bottled water, you know, it's like, this is like, you know, it's very, very convenient and it's become so much a part of our life, but it wasn't always this way. These have only been around for what, 20 something years or so? No, maybe more than that, 30 years. Now, and I'll tell you something that's interesting about this thing about give me convenience or give me death. I went to China in the 1980s and I went to Beijing. And I remember when I was there, I went to, I took a bicycle and rode to Beijing University, Beijing Daxue. And there were all these people. I mean, there were masses of people on bicycles. I mean, it was like literally 10,000 people on bicycles. And the air was dusty, but I could see the blue sky, because Beijing is near the edge of the Gobi Desert, so it has a lot of dust. It's very dry and dusty. But you know, the air wasn't bad. It was dusty, but I could see the blue sky. after China in 30 something years was able to bring 500 million people out of extreme poverty, they started driving cars. And if I've not been to China in over 30 something years now, I mean, I went once, and other than Hong Kong, and then now if you go, I mean, they've rebuilt the infrastructure completely, but they've also now, everybody's driving cars. All those people who were in bicycles are now driving cars. And the air, I'm told, in Beijing is so dirty that you cannot see the blue sky. I mean, now maybe you can because of the pandemic, but that's a temporary thing. Last year, for example, all those people on bicycles were suddenly on cars. So we transported this concept, I don't know, just by example, perhaps, about the convenience and wonderful and how independent you can be with your car. But then there's a price to pay for that. And then instead of all those bicycles, now in China, you see these massive traffic jams with all these cars. Now they are in China doing a lot with the electric vehicles. They have a lot more electric vehicle sales than we do in the US. But still the majority of cars are still, you know, fossil fuel for gasoline, and there's all this pollution. So they went from all these people riding bicycles, which is not very convenient, especially when it rains or it's snowing, but it's also actually healthier for you to bicycle a couple of miles a day as opposed to driving your car. And now the pollution is worse, and then the health is probably worse too, because when you're riding the bicycle, that's pretty healthy for you. So we have to change our mentality and say we should be walking when we can, bicycling when we can, switching to electric vehicles when we can, taking more trains and planes, taking fewer trips, doing more video conferences instead of, you know, these real-time, real-life conferences, and maybe take a lesson from the pandemic. Right now, some 30% of the workforce that is working is doing it from home. Well, maybe that needs to continue. Facebook has already said, Mark Zuckerberg said, that after the pandemic is over, they're reconsidering and thinking about how many of their workers from Facebook can do their work at home and should do it from home to save in terms of the cost of commuting, and save also in terms of, you know, of the buildings and the Facebook campus, et cetera. So that's something I think that Jeff Gibbs and Michael Moore and the Planet of the Humans were correct about, saying that we need to, you know, change our whole mentality on how we believe we can live, and that we cannot continue to consume at the rate that we are. What they were wrong about was they said that renewable energy is a scam, and that's not true. Right now, you know, from hydropower, wind, solar, geothermal, in that order, we have 17.2% of electricity generated in the United States. 12 years ago, that was probably something about 1 or 2%. Coal was 50%. Coal is now 17.1%. And by the end of the year, the expectation is that for the whole year, electricity generated in the United States, more electricity will be generated in the United States renewable energy sources than coal. And that will be a first. And that's a step in the right direction. Now let's get back to some of the, Laura Simpson said, I use cloth diapers for one of my kids who had skin problems. It is a lot. I'm assuming she's saying maybe a lot more comfortable. One thing that happened with the cloth and disposable diapers, and I'm not sure that this is still true, but there was a study that said that when you use cloth diapers, they're more comfortable and better for the baby, for one thing, but it takes more energy to wash the cloth diapers than it does to build and make disposable diapers. But then you've got the disposable diapers going into the landfill. So that's something that it was an issue. And I know a number of women ended up using the disposable ones because when they found out that it takes more energy to clean a cloth diaper. But I don't know if we can talk to the babies to ask them, but I think in general cloth is more comfortable than the disposable ones. So let's see. Tamara Nelson said, this has been a great topic. Thank you. I'm glad you like that. I like it too. And so Again, in case you came in late, let me just run through a few of the facts, if I could. Mr. Elder says, sure, cloth diapers does mean more work, but it's better for our environment. But if it takes more energy, is it better for our environment? It takes more energy to clean them. Tamara Nelson says, washing machines are much more water efficient than before. Ah, good point. You're right. I have not checked this for a number of years because my kids are older, teenagers now. And so that is a good point. If washing machines are a lot more efficient, it may be better just to wash them. So that's a good point. Thank you for bringing that up. So I'm going to run through this very, very quickly, just to, in case you were late, that we have 60 million plastic bottles are thrown away every day, 22 billion a year. So, 80 of the all plastics, only 28.9% are recycled. So plastic bottles, yes, all of them get recycled, but actually for some are able to be recycled, but for some reason, so many, probably because we drink 70 million of these every single day. So many of them ending up inside the ecosystem. And there's the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, the size of Texas in the Pacific Ocean of garbage, in particular plastics. And this will last 1,000 years. 1,000 years later, this plastic will still be around. So Laura Simpson says, we can now have paper inserts, so it is not so much work. I never used the washing machine to clean them. I boiled them in a canner and didn't use more water than that. Ah, good point. Good point. I guess, so there are things that we can do that are sustainable. It is more important, yes, to deal with the bigger issues, societal issues that are sustainable, but we can all make a little bit of a contribution as well and should not ignore our minor contribution of the individual, because ultimately that's what's driving a lot of this, the bigger issues as well. And that the belief that by a lot of the corporations that Americans in particular won't give up their what they love, but 70% of Americans and 80% of young Americans believe that we have the climate change is serious and that we need to address it. And that's good news. 70% of Americans and 80% of young Americans believe that climate change basically needs to be addressed. And that's something that I'm going to be talking about in my next article for TYT Investigates. So, and let me take some more. Let's do some more chatting. One thing that was I saw in doing research for today's topic was that there are a number of companies coming up with sustainable paper cups, straws. That's another thing. There are like a million straws per day used, and those plastic straws end up in the environment and they end up in the ocean and are not recyclable. So in addition to stop drinking, you know, bottled water, stop drinking from plastic straws. But the companies, and this is one of the advantages of capitalism, is that some people have seen a possible opportunity, economic opportunity, and they're building paper straws that are, you can at least drink, finish your drink before they disintegrate, and they disintegrate the paper. Paper plates that are microwavable, unlike some of the light plastic. And so paper plates that are strong enough that they are microwavable and can even have soup in them. And one other thing they did was, and during one of the marathons, this one company came up with a way to put in seaweed their drink. So instead of the marathoners, you know, 20 something or 50,000 marathoners grabbing how many bottles of water in one day, that's, you know, 50,000 marathoners drinking what, how many, 5 or 6 bottles. So we're talking at least 250,000 plastic bottles in one day. Instead of that, what they did was they had these seaweed. They had put in this orange drink in a clear seaweed pouch. And then you just put the whole pouch in your mouth and it dissolves. And so if we use that technology and use capitalism to encourage manufacturers to make that, then that would be one possibility. That's my personal opinion on my politics. I happen to believe that so far the best system seems to be predominantly capitalist, like 2/3 roughly, and 1/3 socialist. And if you don't have that, you know, you need capitalism because people work for themselves. But if you don't have some, you know, significant social programs like unemployment, Social Security, Medicare for all, et cetera, and all those things, and if you don't have that, then capitalism fails, because then we have cycles of depression and huge income gaps, which we do have now. So anyway, I've gotten off on Laura Simpson's. Let's see, Tamara Nelson says, I have reusable straws too. Yay, Tamara. Laura Simpson says, I used paper straws as a kid. They were a pain, but we managed to survive, laughing out loud. Yes. Tamara Nelson says, wow, that is an awesome to hear about the marathon change. That's a huge reduction in paper and plastic cups, plus the garbage to clean up after. Well, it hasn't happened at all the marathons. It was only one marathon. And what happened was the two individuals who own that company, you could look at, I'm sure if you Google seaweed marathon drink seaweed pouch, you'll come up with it. These two engineers went on vacation to Hawaii, and they saw enough garbage and pollution that they had to tell their kids, it used to be cleaner when we were kids. And on the way home, the two of them were talking and said, let's do something about this. And so the two of them made up their, you know, started a company. And their company came up with this idea of these kind of recyclable paper products, but also recyclable using seaweed to put the drinks in the pouch. You know, you make a seaweed pouch, put the drink in it, and you put the whole thing in your mouth. And it was a big hit at one of the marathons. The marathoners loved it, probably because of the orange drink, but it was also more convenient. They didn't have to take the bottle and go like this. They just took the whole pouch, threw it in their mouth, and kept running. And it actually was faster for them. So anyway, and Mr. Elder says, I'm not in my hundreds, I'm 34. Okay, Mr. Elder, glad to hear. So that's kind of like me. I work for the Young Turks, but I'm old. So I'm in my 60s, so any case. Anyway, so now it's 12:08. And I don't know if Ms. Imperator 1 is going to correct me on the time, but if I did make a mistake, please correct me. It's 12:08 now. Okay, I'll read some more. Tamara Nelson says, you have to start somewhere. I hope we can come up with more innovative options like that. So here's an interesting point about innovative options. And I think this is where capitalism can play a role. Again, my personal opinion about capitalism and socialism is that if someone sees an opportunity to make some money and they come up with a good idea and they're able to, through technology and research and development, to come up with, for example, a bottle like this with water in it that's made of seaweed and disintegrates instead of 1,000 years, disintegrates into something that's edible and biodegradable in a short amount of time, but long enough for you to drink, that might work. You know, that might be something. Although I would think that we should just stop drinking bottled water from, you know, throw away plastic or throw away anything. Just, you know, what's hard about getting a bottle? I mean, I guess there are times when, you know, you're stuck and you're really thirsty and better to drink a bottle of water than drink, you know, a Coca-Cola or something, which is not healthy. Although I just found out the other day that a bottle of Coke has about roughly 36 grams of sugar, a can of Coca-Cola, and that the equivalent amount of orange juice has about 35 grams of sugar, and equivalent amount of apple cider has 27 grams of sugar. So I didn't realize how much sugar there was in juice until I started reading about that. Adrian Benningfield says, I have seen alcohol pouches like the water pouches as well. Okay. I don't drink alcohol, so I wouldn't know about that. But when I did drink, I was a Budweiser guy. I drank good old, you know, standard Budweiser, because it was actually a heavy lager and a good. But anyway, so that's interesting that they can make alcohol pouches too. Because if you can keep alcohol in a seaweed pouch, that's pretty strong. I mean, it's got to hold up, because the alcohol would disintegrate and interact more with the pouch than water would. Okay, Katie Kane says goodbye. Bye, Katie. Have a good day. Tamara Nelson says bye, Katie. So I think this might be a good point for us to say goodbye as well. We've been on for about roughly coming up on 40 minutes. So I'm T.Y. Chang from TYT Investigates. Hopefully my story, other article will be coming out this week. Please read it. Be safe, be healthy, take care. And I'll be back on Friday at 11:30 Eastern Time. Jonathan Larson will be back tomorrow. He's on Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday. I'm on Wednesday and Friday. So take care.